Welcome to Qualifying an Opportunity, part of the Building Big Software series. Every great piece of software starts as an idea, not just an idea, but rather a well-qualified idea, an idea which has stood up to the scrutiny of someone trying to figure out if they can build a good business around it. How do you go about finding an opportunity, and what's the process to figure out whether it's qualified to be a good business opportunity? Hi, I'm John Miller, the Deliberate Engineer. I spent 30 years working as a software engineer in big tech and a variety of other places, working with a bunch of different technologies. I spent 15 of those years as a principal engineer and 13 of them as a software engineering manager. Over those years, I've participated in the definition and the creation of lots of big software services, ranging from something that has just a dozen people working on it to projects that have hundreds or even thousands of people. At Microsoft, I worked on a variety of V1 products as well as V1 features for very large products like Windows. These include things like networking services, content distribution services, innovative hardware such as the Microsoft Touch Mouse, and even standalone products. In addition to the time at Microsoft, I also spent time at Amazon working on their digital product line, including the Fire Phone and Fire devices, Kindle backend services, and some of the Kindle client work. At Oracle, I got to work on Cloud V2, which was their reimagining of what cloud services should be. Before we get started, a disclaimer. I've been involved in many V1 products and I've worked at a lot of big companies, but out of all the areas I'm going to talk about in the Building Big Software series, this is the one that I know the least about. Typically, product definition, defining opportunities and how to meet them is something that's handled much higher up the corporate food chain. For example, by the executives or by people who specialize in it, such as product managers, marketing managers, and so on. So I've been around this type of work, but I haven't done a lot of it myself. The biggest project that I really helped define and push out was probably 10 people. I've seen enough of it to know how things work. You should take that as the value from this video rather than assuming it's been written by an expert in product definition. That's not where my main talents lie. When you're talking about opportunities to base a business around, I lump them into two broad categories. The first is opportunities that you go out looking for. You try and define a brand new product category or come up with an idea that you're going to be able to base a product around. The second is things which are a natural outcropping or a natural extension of work that you're already doing at your company. Let's say that you want to build a big product from scratch and you need to find where you're going to do that. The first thing you need to do is familiarize yourself with the industry and with the areas that you think would be a right place to pick up a new opportunity. Ideally, you want to leverage some experience that's fairly unique to you, some strength that you have that can guide you in a good direction. But let's say that I worked summers for 8 or 9 years in construction, and during that time I got to know a bunch of people in the construction trade, and I stayed in touch with them. This might be a natural place for me to look and see if I could build some sort of software. I might take a look at the construction industry and realize, hey, you know what, a common problem that all these different construction firms have is that they have difficulty with logistics. It's especially problematic for them to track and update tracking of when different things are going to arrive, how long they're going to take to use, and what the knock-on effect is of any delays in the arrival of the raw products into producing a house and finishing the house. The first thing I would do is work through my contacts and my network of friends to figure out just how big a problem this is. Not just figure out if it's a problem, but to quantify and qualify it. In other words, I want to take a look and say, well, how frequently does this happen? How much is the delay typically? How many different pieces of inventory have to be brought onto a build site before the construction is complete? What's the knock-on impact and the cost to the construction firm of any delays that come up from that? How common are the delays? If I can't get enough information to disqualify this idea from my network of contacts, then the next step is for me to actually start investing both time and money in learning more about the domain. So after I've talked to my friends, I might take a look and see if I can buy reports or pay for somebody to go and do an investigation of the overall market to find out if the conclusions that I've reached from my informal survey of my friends and colleagues matches a broader need in the industry. I'll also want to pin down different attributes of the market demand. For example, is this something that only small construction firms would need, and so I'd have to sell 100,000 copies of my service to 100,000 different companies? Or is it something that the bulk of construction in, that this would be useful for is being done by large firms, and I only need to sell copies of it to 1,000 companies rather than 100,000? Is it an opportunity just in my state or in my entire country, or is it something that might even be an international opportunity? Are there regulatory angles that I have to look at? All of this is information that takes time and money and energy to go and find out, but it's a critical part of gathering information to be able to qualify your idea. Once I've done this, I have enough information that it's time to start narrowing my idea of what the product is going to be and dig down into it. The second type of opportunity you can look for is something which is a natural extension of a business you're already in. Amazon started as a bookselling company in the late 1990s and the early 2000s. As they grew and became more popular, they realized that they needed to decompose their monolithic web service into a series of services that could work together and scale better. While they were doing this, they realized that they were probably not unique in this need, and that's really the genesis of AWS, Amazon Web Services. The initial offering from AWS to their customers only covered a couple different silos of functionality. One of these was S3, or the Simple Storage Service. The second service they offered was something called SQS, or the Simple Queuing Service. Both of these are fundamental basis services for trying to build a distributed service. Amazon didn't stop here. They built a series of additional services, each one sort of extending the business they were already in. Well, shortly after their initial offering, they released EC2, or Elastic Compute, for customers to be able to run virtual machines on Amazon infrastructure. Next, they released EBS, or the Elastic Block Store. Fast forward and you find that Amazon has produced more than a dozen different services that they offer to their customers and enable third parties to build experiences ranging anywhere from something that supports just a couple of clients to something that scales up to hundreds of millions or even billions of clients. So this is really an example of a business leveraging their strengths and the market they already had to forge out into new areas. Whether the opportunity you identify comes from scratch or it comes from extending your current business, the work you're going to have to do for much of the rest of it is going to be the same. You have to take a look and figure out whether the business opportunity justifies the investment of time and capital to turn it into a product. You need to get an idea of the competitive landscape and the number of people who are already in that domain. If there's nobody in that domain, you'll need to take a look and figure out what sort of advantages you have that you can leverage to help fight off competitors and keep your share of the market as other people get into that space. Making a new big product is a huge investment, not just for you, but for everybody who you involve in that process. It can take literally years of their lives. There's a real cost to this in terms of how hard people work and how much they get rewarded. And there's also an opportunity cost. While they're doing this, they're not doing other things. Before you really jump into a business, I can't overstress, it's critical that you understand the implications of that business and that you do your homework up front to make sure that it's going to be a good business to be in, that this opportunity is really something you want to pursue. Otherwise, you risk absolutely devastating your own life and the life of everybody who's involved in your venture. The qualification process up front is a relatively small part of the overall software building process, but it's critical. Don't underestimate its value. And don't try and cut corners or do things yourself that you don't know how to do. Getting back to how you go about qualifying the opportunity, once you have the opportunity, it's time to ask yourself a series of questions that will help you identify whether it's something that you really want to pursue. First, you want to understand if this is an opportunity that's already been identified and is being pursued by other companies. Read trade magazines, do internet searches, go through your friends and contacts to figure out if this is a space other people are working in. Learn about the industry. See if you can find announcements either of existing products or products that are planned. It can also lead you into a business that you're simply not equipped to be able to work in. The second thing that you need to do is scope what a minimum viable product or MVP will require for you to deliver it. How many people will you need for how long? What sort of manufacturing capabilities do you need? What sort of distribution? What will it cost for the marketing? Do you have an idea of how to move the product forward beyond the MVP? Can you deliver the MVP in a reasonable amount of time before the market changes? Coming up with a laundry list of all the different things that you'll need to do to pursue the opportunity can be exhausting, and it can involve working in a lot of domains you know very little about or nothing about. Even for the domains you're familiar with, like engineering, you may have trouble answering the question of how many engineers will be required for how long. Even if you don't have an exact answer, you need to come up with a ballpark. You need to know the order of magnitude of effort that's going to be required. Is it going to be 10 engineers, 100 engineers? 1,000 engineers? Do you need a dedicated sales team? Do you need a marketing team? You need to get an idea of how many different groups will be need to be hired on to realize the MVP. The third question that you need to answer is what makes you uniquely qualified to pursue this opportunity? Are you an expert in the field? Do you have an existing customer base that you can leverage to move things forward? Do you know more about this space than anybody else? You really need to understand why this is a good space in particular for you to get into, not just because you thought of it, but because you have some sort of a material persistent advantage that will let you keep working in that space and continue to be successful even as other people come in and try and enter the space as well. Along these lines, you need to have some sort of a business forecast. Understand how big the market is and how much of it you'll be able to take advantage of. You need to have a forecast not just for when the product releases, but for some period of time after that, so that you know whether it's a product where you sell it once and everybody has one and they don't need it anymore, or whether this is going to be an ongoing growing marketplace, or whether it's something that will require refinement and so you'll be able to consistently sell upgrades and upsell your existing customers. As you evaluate these different questions and other questions like them, you need to make sure that you understand your strengths and weaknesses. In particular, when you're talking about marketing or sales or advertising, anything like this, you absolutely have to understand. If you're not already an expert in those domains, you're not going to be able to learn enough to make a qualified decision early on. You need to engage experts, whether those are people you bring in as partners or those are people who you hire to do the work for you. Even huge companies like Procter & Gamble often work with external firms for vetting advertising, for figuring out market strategies, for looking at the evolution of the market and predicting how it's going to behave over the next several years. They're a huge global company, and yet they still have to seek out experts to do this work. They recognize the limitations just as you should recognize your limitations. You may be hesitant to hire help or to involve other people. People come up with an idea and they're very wedded to that idea and think, this is the best thing ever. I have to keep this secret so that nobody else steals my idea. Ideas are worthless on their own. Just having an idea doesn't mean anything. Among other things, you can't protect that idea. You can't keep other people from using that idea. Even patents are intended to protect a certain method of creating whatever that idea is. It doesn't keep other people from pursuing the same idea. So as you think about whether you want to dedicate a lot of your life to this or whether you want to get some help and make sure that you do a better job of qualifying your opportunities, realize it's not the idea that matters nearly as much as execution on that idea, assembling a great team to be able to pursue it, to make this big software product, and having the expertise that tells you whether you really want to dedicate the next couple years of your life to it and get other people involved, or whether you'd be better off either looking for a different opportunity or sticking with the work that you're already doing. In summary, every big software product starts out as an idea, but that's not where it ends. When you have an idea, when you've identified an opportunity, you need to figure out how to qualify that opportunity and make sure it's really something worth investing time and energy and passing up the possibility of doing other work. Make sure it's worth that. You'll have to get help to do this. It's going to be expensive. It's going to take time, but it's just a drop in the bucket compared to all the work that will follow in building your big product. So it's absolutely worth doing. Have you been involved in building some sort of a big product in the past? Does the advice that I'm giving you here ring true, or do you have additional advice that you'd give people? Or do you think that there's something else that they should be doing to come up with a business idea and pursue it for, especially for large software projects? I'd love to hear your stories and your thoughts down below. Please leave a comment. Thank you very much for making it this far through the video and keep on pushing forward. Hi, this is John. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please think about subscribing so you get notified of my future videos. Also, if you are interested, you might want to check out the video I have linked here. Thanks and keep on pushing forward.